So thank you for coming to class and listening to what we have to say. So I meant to put this up at the beginning of the week, but I forgot. So the first lecture was introductory anyway. So today's lecture, I'm going to give you a broad overview of rheology, starting from basics, like continuum mechanics, and then really just focusing on why granular materials are different and why we have to be more careful in dealing with them. Ultimately, my objective in doing this rheology lecture is to show that in certain ways, what engineers have come up with in constructing a continuum model for granular systems is reminiscent of some very well-known statistical mechanics models that we use. In particular, there's a connection to something called Ginzburg-Landau theory that Kabir will then discuss in the tutorial. So the objective of this is to say, even though rheology, continuum mechanics, there are usually no statistical descriptions associated with these, in the granular context looks like there is, you have to be thinking about noisy systems and Stat-Mecky descriptions, and there are some connections to well-known Stat-Mech models that we would at some point like to make more rigorous connections. No one has made those rigorous connections yet. So tomorrow's lecture will be, again, so this is all sort of building up, introduction to equilibrium statistical mechanics, focusing on the idea of statistical ensembles. Again, what I want to do is really probe deeply into what are the assumptions that go into establishing these ensembles, because on Saturday then we want to extend those ideas to the granular materials and this whole approach called the Edwards ensemble. So unless we sort of go through all of the conditions that need to go into describing equilibrium Stat-Mech, we will not know how to generalize it to the granular systems. Sunday will be a lecture on jamming and unjamming, and then next week we will delve more deeply into actually working out things for granular systems using the statistical ensemble and some techniques that we have been coming up with that we sort of mentioned during the first lecture about how to write down partition functions for granular materials, etc. Okay, so for most of the talk today, most of the lecture today, I will be using the blackboard. So let me start by talking about just normal elasticity and continuum mechanics. Okay, so how many of you have taken anything on continuum mechanics? Most physics departments don't do anything. Engineers probably have, right? Yeah, so again, I think one of the nice things about granular materials, but also a challenge, is that we are bringing all of these things. So things that engineers know very well, physicists don't know. And then some of the things physicists know and engineers don't. Okay, so I'm going to start from basics and say, okay, so what do I want? I want to try and come up first with how we go about looking at elastic solids in a continuum mechanics description. So a microscopic model that's good to keep in your head as an elastic solid is just a ball and spring network. Okay, so I can just have a completely ordered spring, like every spring, so I can make up a triangular lattice, let's say. And I have springs connecting each of them. This would be the simplest possible thing. Each of these are springs, but let's say the same spring constant, in which case this will be a completely ordered solid in some sense, but I can also make up elastic network models with springs where there is some disorder in the underlying spring networks, in the sense that either maybe these springs have different equilibrium lengths, or they might have different spring constants. You can do random spring networks. All of those can be mapped onto some elastic solid. So microscopically, this is what one would do. And the point is, if I take a bunch of springs like this, and let's say I'm just even sitting at zero temperature, I could just minimize the energy. I can take an infinite array of this, or I can take something with periodic boundary conditions. I can just just minimize the energy, right? It's just a bunch of sum of spring energy terms, right? So I can just minimize the energy. I'll get some equilibrium positions of these masses. Right? Everyone with me? Right? So I just minimize the energy. I don't need to. So the point is, I can take an infinite system or wrap it around. I know the energy function, so I can minimize the energy, and I end up with an equilibrium configuration of the masses. So this is a well-defined zero stress state of such a spring network. Right? I haven't imposed any stresses on it. I haven't distorted it. I haven't done anything. I've just minimized the energy, and I get some positions. So now, how do we understand, how do we look at elasticity? I now want to look at the response of this to a strain, and how that, so if I can, I can pull on this a little bit and ask how much does the energy change, and that should give me a stress-strain relationship. So basically, if I want to look at the microscopics, then I can recalculate the forces, and that will give me the stresses and the strengths. So in continuum picture, what do we want to do? In the continuum picture, I want to go to a coarse grained description where I talk about stresses and strains instead of forces at every node. So now I'm going to look at it from, like, I'm not looking at it at this level. I'm looking at it from very far away in some sense, where there are lots and lots of these nodes and springs. I can think of this as a continuum. And on that continuum then, I'm going to, so this is the continuum mechanics part of it. I'm going to draw a small box. This is some material position inside the box. Is everyone with me, right? So I'm just going to think of this as a continuum. This is some point in that continuum. I'm going to draw a box around it. I have my Cartesian coordinates. Let's call these x, y, and z. So I have a box. And what I want to do now, the reason we introduce a stress tensor is, suppose I look at this face, and there is some force acting on this face, and each face is then characterized by a, how do I characterize a face in such a box? By a unit normal, right? So I have a unit normal, and then there's some force acting on this face that I'll denote by F of n. That F of n, the jth component of it, the jth Cartesian component of it, I can write as sigma ij ni, where this defines then my stress tensor. So the reason I need a tensor is I have two vectors sitting, I shouldn't put up. So this is the jth component of that vector. So on each face, I have a F that I'm denoting by n, right? And each of these has three components, three Cartesian components, and I get the Cartesian components by contracting the stress tensor with the unit normal vector. Okay, so this defines for me the stress tensor. So now on this phase, right, I can have, this will be sigma xx, this is sigma xy, this is sigma xz. Yes, this is my x direction, x, y, z. Correct me if I am not, and on this one, the one along this direction would be sigma y, y, then I will have a sigma y, x and a sigma y, z. Yes? Correct me, right? So I end up then in a, for a three dimensional system, all of the force information then is captured by the Cauchy stress tensor, whose components then, so in 3D I have sigma xx, sigma xy, sigma xz. Now this is sigma yx, but there is a condition on sigma xy and sigma yx. They have to be equal because there are no net torques in this system. So this, so then I have a completely symmetric tensor. Now of course these are fields, right? So I can have a system, so this doesn't have to be the same everywhere, right? So I can look at it here, I can draw another box somewhere else here, and that stress tensor can be different, right? So this is a field, so if I call this the stress tensor, so each of these are functions of the position that we are looking at. Have I said anything that's, most of you, this is something that you have seen at some point or reasonably familiar with? Or at least you are not getting surprised by what I am saying. Yes? Yeah? Questions? All I have done is defined a stress tensor, right? So, okay. So now, given this, can I in an elastic solid come up with a solution to the stress field given conditions of momentum conservation and some constitutive relation? Okay, so if this is a solid, solid that I erased, if it's not, let's say there's no gravitational forces, there are no external forces, then what is the condition for mechanical equilibrium? Right, so if there is no body force, then the divergence of sigma is 0. Physics students, are you guys okay with that? Right? Which is, so divergence of sigma is equal to 0. If there were body forces, I would put in a body force on this side. Okay, so let's now see. So, in 3D, how many independent components do I have?
Six.
Six. Let's do 2D because it's easier. So, in 2D, how many independent components do I have? Three, right? In 2D, how many equations do I have in here? Two equations, right? So I have two equations and I have three unknowns. So So just by giving you the mechanical equilibrium conditions, I cannot solve for the stress field. So I'm emphasizing this because when we come to granular materials, we'll find that the closure that we use in elastic systems, we don't have anymore for granular systems. So what else can I, so what can I say for an elastic, solid? There's a something called a constitutive relation, which relates stress to strain. So I can write sigma ij, I have some elastic modulus tensor, and I'm going to call this gamma KL, that's my strain tensor. Okay, so this fourth rank tensor is in, so in isotropic solids there are only two independent components, there's a bulk modulus and a shear modulus, but normally this is a fourth rank tensor. So isotropic solids can be characterized just by two numbers. But this is the general relation. Okay, is everyone, so this is the constitutive relation, and then the question is, if I give you that, can I now come up with an equation for this, another equation in addition to this that will let me figure out what the stress field looks like? Gamma KL is not unknown for here. So, well, it's unknown in the sense that, yeah, it's still a field, right? So what I need is something that's generic, a relationship that's independent of exactly what the form of the strain field is. So that's what we will talk about. So there's something called, so what is the strain tensor? How do I define a strain tensor? And remember, we are now looking at this elastic body. So we are basing everything on saying, I had a zero stress equilibrium set of positions, right? So now if I want to define a strain about that, then the strain is uniquely specified by gamma KL. So what happens here? So these are the positions, these are the equilibrium positions, and then I can define displacements about them. Can you guys see this, what I'm writing here? Maybe I should, can we raise this up and then bring it down again when I need it? Is it okay? What did I call it? I could have made it. So what did I say? I said sigma ij, and I?
So it's usually in the opposite sense, Fi equals sigma ij,
right? Sure, yeah, yeah. It doesn't matter, yes, right. So let's do that. That's the normal convention. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, there are two, doesn't matter, yeah, let's stick to this convention, it's fine. Okay, so what is a strain, so now if I have, oh, it's good, so now can we turn this off the, or I'll write here. So now what do I mean by a strain? I have some displacements about these equilibrium positions. So in a continuum approach, I'm saying each mass point right, so there's a displacement compared to where my mass was before it got moved around, right? So I'm just taking my things and moving them around. And then the strain tensor is related to this displacement field. I'm just going to use this notation. So the strain tensor is the symmetrized derivative of the displacement field. Remember, now we have gone to sort of a continuum description. Everything, the masses are sort of now continuously distributed. So I'm looking, thinking of this displacement as a field, and I'm looking at the derivative. So this is, so if I want to look at gamma xy, is the derivative of the x component of the displacement with y respect to y plus the derivative of the y component of the displacement with respect to x. Okay. Just from this, you can work out that there is a compatibility relation, which then lets me close the stress equation. So all I'm relying upon is the fact that the strain tensor is built from derivatives of the displacement fields. If I give you that, you can take derivatives of this explicitly to, now I'm doing this in 2D, to show that del y square gamma xx plus del x square gamma yy minus 2 del x del y gamma xy is equal to 0. So going back to what you're saying, I don't know what the strain tensor is, but just by the fact that the strain tensor is constructed from this displacement field, it has to satisfy this compatibility condition. It's just because, so this is coming just, if I take gamma xx, take two derivatives, I'll get cross derivatives of the displacement fields, right? The fact that the strain tensor is constructed out of the displacement field gives me this condition. Okay. So I haven't used anything else, right? I have just used this. Now I'm going to use this constitutive relation to get an equation for the stress tensor. Again, I can take second derivatives of the stress, right? Use the second derivatives of the strain tensor, this compatibility relation, and I end up with an equation about involving the derivatives of the stress components. So again, I'm going to write it down in 2D. And this now involves fourth derivatives. And I'm going to use and this is true for all sigma ij is equal to 0. Now, R and T are the two components of lambda ij kl that give me the two independent elastic constants for an isotropic solid. So this I'm specializing to isotropic solid. If you want to do an isotropic solids, it'll be more complicated. But what I wanted to see, show, my main emphasis here is, if I have just the mechanical equilibrium conditions, I cannot solve for the stresses in an elastic body. But if I know what the elastic moduli are, and I have this relationship, which is a constitutive relationship between stress and strain, then I get an additional equation for the stresses, and that's all I need to solve for the stress field. Right, so this is sort of generic, like even in fluids, I can use momentum conservation and constitutive relations to solve for stress fields, etc. Here for an elastic body, what I'm trying to emphasize is if I just had this, I would not be able to solve for the stress tensor. But having this constitutive relation and the fact that the strain tensor is related to the displacement field gives me a closure relation. So this is the normal closure relation that's used in elastic bodies to solve for the stress tensor. All it depends upon is knowing the elastic moduli. So if I assume that I have linear elasticity and I have a solid which is in mechanical equilibrium, I can solve for the stresses inside that body by using these equations in conjunction with that equation. Okay, so my main point in this is that I do need this closure. Okay, I need this sort of linear elasticity equation for me to be able to solve for the stress field in an elastic solid. So that's what then goes missing when I look at granular materials. The reason is, and I will all, okay, so now I'll have to make the screen come down again. Okay, thank you, Dubhashish. But the basic reason is again that in granular materials, two things. One is that the zero stress state is not well defined. Okay, while it's coming down, so in granular materials, and so what I'm going to do in a minute is give you like a soil mechanics person's perspective of how they think about granular materials, and then we will think more about dense flows. Our main, what has been happening in my group is we've been really trying to focus on granular solids and trying to understand if we can come up with closure relations that can replace these kinds of equations for granular systems, but that we will talk about next week. But I wanted to point out that this is missing in the granular system. So I don't, and the reason is, because I have no cohesion, right, I cannot define, there's no well-defined zero stress equilibrium position about which I can displace something. So there is no unique sort of equilibrium solid that I can define. If I'm at zero temperature and I have no attractive interactions, right, then unless I put some pressure on the boundaries, I push on something, then there's nothing to keep them together, right? Does that make sense? I have to tell you what the pressure is. Unless I, so for my elastic network, for my spring network, I didn't have to tell you what the pressure is, right? I just minimize my energy, right? There's no sort of self stresses inside there. If I have equal springs, I can minimize the energy of each of them. There's no problem. They're all nicely energy minimized, and I have some nice configuration. I don't know how to do that because I have one-sided springs in some way. Right? So it's because these things are cohesionless. There's nothing to keep them together unless I do something to them. Right? So if I either that can be gravity or that can be something that I'm putting in a box and pushing on them. Because if I don't do that, then why would they stay together at all, right? There's nothing for them to keep them together. So there is no such relationship. So in the physics granular community, there has been a long-standing sort of quest of finding what is called the missing, so it's called the missing stress geometry equation. So the point is there something that I can come up with for granular systems which replaces this equation that I don't have in granular systems? Okay, and we will talk a little bit more about that next week as to where what people have done, what we've been trying to do. And in finding that closure, we will talk a little bit more about what we mentioned that during the first lecture, that so remember you saw that these force chains were propagating sort of like wave or like lightning, you know, the force chains, the forces are localized and get propagated almost like wave fronts, right, rather than normal elastic solid propagation. So these equations, if R and T are both positive, give you sort of nice stress solutions, so that if I perturb something somewhere, then I get a homogeneous response everywhere else. It's like looking at Laplace's equations. So if you think about Laplace's equations and solutions to Laplace's equations, there are usually no localized variations. It's the smoothest it has to be, right? So these are elliptic equations as far as differential equations are concerned. So elliptic equations have very smooth solutions, and wave equations have like rays and propagations. So one thing that people have been talking about for a while is that the closure relations that one gets here actually leads to hyperbolic equations with the stress propagation, and that's what gives you these force chains, etc. But still it's a debatable thing. It's not something that has been completely sorted out yet. So we will come back to that next week. But for now, let's remember that what we can do in elastic solids, we cannot do for the granular solids. So what do soil mechanics people, so the way I understand what soil mechanics, and these guys should correct me if I'm wrong, is they say, well, okay, I don't know, so there's no sort of nice, clear, solid-like granular material that I can think about. Right? It's not like there's no unique state that I can think about without compressing it. But there is something that's special which is called the critical state. And that critical state has this property. So there are two properties that a critical state has. And what is this critical state? So the way you think about it is you take a bunch of grains or take soil and you deform it until it just starts flowing. Okay, so going back to what I was saying here, so let's go back a little bit. Okay, I'm going too fast, hang on. Okay, so if I take a granular solid, then there is always failure due to what is called Coulomb failure. So you guys tell me what Coulomb failure is, and tell your colleagues too. I can say it, but what is Coulomb failure? Right, so at every contact, remember we talked about the fact that the tangential force has to be less than or equal to mu times Fn, right? So locally, I can violate that condition. Macroscopically, there is an equivalent condition, which is to say that the shear stress, so Coulomb failure is a basic mechanism of plasticity in granular solids. So this failure at the local level is when I violate that condition. So my tangential force is no longer less than or equal to mu times Fn. So then what will happen to that contact? the conduct will slip. So this can lead collectively to a macroscopic condition where the shear stress over the pressure becomes equal to some macroscopic failure friction coefficient. So this is what characterizes, this doesn't have to be the microscopic friction coefficient at every contact, right? But there is a macroscopic friction coefficient when the shear stress over the pressure becomes equal to that, the system just begins to flow. That's the yield stress of the system. The system yields at that point. So the yield stress then is tau is mu s times p. So in a granular Coulomb failure context, something with an yield stress gets represented in this form. It's completely phenomenological. So this is there, that locally there is something going on. What engineers have seen is that there is this special critical state, which is when things just start to flow, and in that state, the shear stress versus pressure follows a straight line, roughly. It's an idealized picture. I don't think it's completely rigorously valid for real grains, but it's an idealized picture. And it's an interesting idealized picture because then what soil mechanicists say is, I don't know how to characterize a granular solid. There is no sort of nice properties of that. But this critical state has some nice properties. This critical state where it's sort of a marginal solid, it's just going to flow, but it is not flowing yet. There's no shear, there's no velocity, but it's just marginally stable. That marginal state has some properties where shear stress over pressure is some constant number, and there is this other relationship, which is the specific volume of this critical state has a logarithmic dependence on the pressure. So there is a well characterized marginal state that they call critical state, and then the idea is, can we then perturb about that and ask how solids behave around that? The idea is left to themselves, like if you keep deforming something, everything will go to that state. So under some continuous deformation, under continuous shear, granular materials will get to the critical state. If I am at a specific volume that's lower than this, so the specific volume is lower means I am denser, right? If I'm denser, then I dilate under shear until I reach this state. If I am specific volume higher, so I am more, I am looser packed. If I'm looser packed, then as I shear it, I will compact and get to this critical state. So it's actually pressure or normal stress. So let me, so it could be pressure or normal stress. So the most of the setups under which this is done, you should really think of rather than pressure as normal stress. So I had this up here and then I went. So let's think of this setup. So this is a thought experiment or an idealized experiment where I'm putting a normal stress on it. So these are rough plates, these are grains at some density. I'm going to hold it at some normal stress. So it's not hydrostatic pressure. It's just uniaxial compression. So I'm compressing it in this direction. Everyone with me? And then I shear it. Then I impose a shear stress. So I keep it pressed at some normal stress, and then I impose a shear. And then I ask what happens to this system. So if I am at densities that are higher than my critical state density, then as I keep this fixed and I shear, the system dilates. You will actually see the plate move up. But the way it does it is not homogeneously. This is again all schematic. There is a region within here where it dilates. So there is actually failure, but localized failure inside here. It is not homogeneously dilating. So there will be a localized region here where the system deforms a lot, the density goes down, and the system flows here, but it doesn't flow, so here it has really undergone plastic yielding, it has just completely failed. If I look at what happens to the shear stress and the relationship of the shear stress to the strain rate, so the strain rate is, so what am I controlling here? I'm controlling S, and if the system flows, I will get a measure a non-zero strain rate, right? So what you see here is that I increase the stress all the way up to a critical stress and it's not flowing, right? The gamma dot is zero. Then it starts yielding. So this is when you start forming these localized failure things, and then this shear stress asymptotically reaches some constant value, and then the system is flowing at that constant stress, right? So then it has failed. Does that make sense?
So after this it behaves like a fluid.
After this it behaves like a fluid. Yes. Sudden as a function of time? I think so, right, it depends on, I don't know what the transient is, I actually don't know. But sudden in the sense that it has to reach a shear stress, right? So, right, exactly. So once I reach that critical shear stress, then I'll flow. But if you're asking if I hold it at a certain shear stress, does it take time for it to relax? I don't think there is any such relaxation time. I think that happens instant. The response is instantaneous. So all of this stuff is completely phenomenological. But people know it, people have used it forever. So the kinds of things that you talk about in granular solids in the context of soil mechanics is this type of failure, which is dilation. And I can also look at what is the failure locus. So this is the shear stress as a function of N for different densities. So the higher I make the density, so this is higher than that, the higher I make the density, I shift the shear stress to higher and higher values for the same normal stress. But there's an yield locus, right? So this is the line at which my solid will yield and flow. And it yields and flows through this Coulomb failure process. Again, I emphasize that this is all phenomenological, but it's pretty well established. But as I was saying during the first lecture, the microscopic mechanism underlying dilation, I don't think we still completely understand. Okay, why something dilates when in a granular system? So the zeroth order argument is, think of these as completely rigid grains, right? Completely hard particles. if I have compressed them, if I have a high enough density so that they are jammed, then for them to move under shear, they have to go over one another. And to do that, they have to expand. So that's the usual argument given. Okay, that is a completely kinematic argument, that for things to be able to flow, it will not flow until it can dilate. For it to be able to flow, I have to have like one layer of grains be able to slide over another layer, and for that to happen, I have to move up. But what that kinematic argument does not address is what I think we now know pretty much, that frictionless grains don't undergo dilation. So nowhere in the kinematic argument does friction come into play, except for the fact that as soon as I talk about Coulomb failure, I'm talking about friction, right? So that's somewhere in there. But the kinematic argument that everyone uses does not ever refer back to that, the difference between frictional and frictionless. Okay, so why am I saying all of these things? I'm trying to emphasize in here that the state of a granular solid is highly sensitive to the stresses imposed on it. Unlike an elastic material where there are regimes of linear response, right? So I can start from something, I can put a little bit of, I can strain it a little bit, and the stress goes linearly with strain. Here, because of all of these Coulomb failures and the fact that I can actually change the structure, my density couples to shear, right? Then it's telling me that the response of these systems is highly inelastic all the time. There's very little regime over which my response is, can be couched in the language of linear elasticity. And so, and the other concept, so we will come back to, so when I talk about jamming and unjamming on Sunday, one kind of jamming that we will talk about is through shearing, and that actually is sort of the other side of the coin from this setup. So here, what are we doing? I'm putting some normal stress, I'm shearing it, and what we argued was that this system then dilates. So the system wants to increase its volume. Now what might happen if I, instead of keeping the normal stress fixed, I actually kept the volume fixed. I imposed something on it, so I said I will not let the volume go up, and I'll shear it. Since the volume cannot go up, then if you're really at high densities, then you'll just undergo sort of fracture at some point. But if you're at reasonably low densities, still above this critical density, so that you would like to dilate, but I'm not letting you dilate, then what can happen is I actually create more contacts between the grains, because they'll have to come into, they'll have to somehow fill up these spaces. And so I can cause shear induced jamming, which is just the other side of the coin from dilation. So the system, it's the same physics, and neither of those we understand completely yet. So the same physics that leads to dilation leads to shear jamming if I shear something at constant volume. So we will talk about that on Sunday, and you'll see that their friction is, plays a crucial role. So from this very phenomenological perspective, what we are saying is that imposed stresses can completely change the kinds of microstructure that I have in my granular solids. So I can make and break contacts. I can change things completely. So it's hard to imagine a linear elastic theory that will be able to describe the stress strain relationships of granular materials. So I'm going to put up what forget the name from Schofield and Roth. So we have been saying things for a while, which I found really, really nicely sort of stated here in this engineering soil mechanics book written in the 1960s. What the authors are saying, and you can start reading from here, as engineers we speak loosely of the relationship between stress increment and strain increment. We just say stress strain relationships, right? Because most of the time we are thinking we are starting from a zero stress state. So the strain increment or the stress increment is the same as stress and strain. So I have a zero strain, zero stress state. But for granular solids or people who are doing soil mechanics, you're always starting from an initially stressed state. There is no zero stress solid that I have. I have no well-defined solid state at zero stress. So I'm always starting from some initially stressed state. Once I start from this initially stressed state, and I add some incremental stress to it, there's no reason to believe that I can, the displacement in response to the, so the displacement in response to that will depend on the actual stress state that I have and the stress increment that I put on it, because things are so highly nonlinear. So all of the stuff that we do in elasticity, we say, okay, so I'm going to add some, I can keep adding the strains because I have linear superposition, it's all linear, I can all, none of that can we do here, is the point that these guys are trying to make. Right, so then the problem of solving for the stress field in a granular system is still, in my mind, a completely unsolved problem, and which is why we still don't understand why stresses get localized, why stresses get transmitted in this particular way, right? Not from a very fundamental perspective on the stress at that point.
Yeah.
Exactly, exactly. So the constitutive relation is not a given. The constitutive relation depends on the state of stress.
That introduces the
nonlinearity. And to me, I think the fundamental reason for that is that my contacts can break and form all the time. So in elasticity, when I have the spring network, right, the reason I have linear response is when I distort it just by a little bit, but the springs don't break. The springs just distort a little bit, right? But now if I have grains that are just touching, let's say, right, and I distort something a little bit, I'll break contacts. And I'll change the network completely, right? So that network does not have to have some smooth relationship to the network that I started with, because there are no nice springs holding them together. So the idea then that we will explore more next week is how do we try to think of these force localizations, and we'll talk about some of the things that we have been doing in our group, how others have thought about this missing stress geometry equation, how you can get hyperbolic equations, etc. For the rest of today, right, I have half an hour, right? I have half an hour. For the rest of today, this is what I want to do. I want to talk about a slightly different problem, or a slightly different, so in this critical state, right, I said this is the point where things are just marginally flowing. And in this marginally flowing state, my shear stress over pressure is equal to some constant mu. Yeah? Now let's imagine that I want to study the rheology of flows, but dense flows. So I have granular systems that I can divide up into. So far we talked about granular solids in some very qualitative way, but trying to emphasize what the difference is with elastic solids. And so this is the realm in engineering of soil mechanics. And for us, it's try to understand some kind of statistical basis for trying to understand force localization, and we'll come back to that next week. Then on this other side, we have rapid flows, which is the realm of kinetic theory, which I'm not going to touch upon at all. So this is granular gases, very, very dilute granular systems flowing very rapidly. And in the middle, we have sort of the difficult situation of dense flows. And what I want to talk about a little bit for the rest of the lecture today is the rheology, the description, the continuum rheology description, or the constitutive relations that people have come up with for dense flows, because I want to show connections so that there is a notion in this dense flow rheology of something called a noise temperature. I'll show you a couple of experiments, but before that I'll set up the theory for you. So there's this notion of noise temperature and activated processes, which are really, really reminiscent of thermally activated processes in normal solids. So even though this is being done in the context of granular solids, the theoretical framework starts looking very similar to what we know how to do in sort of regular equilibrium statistical mechanics. So this noise temperature has lots in common with actual temperature, and then that will lead into the Edwards ensemble stuff that I'll talk about tomorrow. This is specific volume higher, so I have loose sand or loose clay. Imagine taking that loose clay in your hand and doing something to it, deforming it. And so for soil mechanics, there's always some water in there. And what the idea is that if this thing is actually now compactifying, because it wants to go to the critical state, the water will come and wet your hands. Whereas if you're here, this is like us walking on that beach, when because it was dilating, the water was going underneath, so the pores were opening up and the water was going inside the soil, so your hands would get dry. So that's why they use it. So it's dense and loose, but they call it wet and dry, because you have this idea that you're deforming this clay or soil, and in one case your hands will become wet, in the other case your hands will become dry as you deform it. So as you deform it, in one case you have more water coming out, in the other case more water is going in because you're opening up more space and your hands get dry. Okay, so here is a generalization of this critical state tau over p relationship to a dense rheology, and it's based on, okay, I don't necessarily have to go through this, so it's called mu of I rheology. I'll define each of the things. So mu by definition is tau over p, the shear stress over the pressure. I is a dimensionless number, which is a ratio of two time scales. And this is where the granular part of the system comes in. So one time scale is related to the imposed shear rate, or the shear rate that I'm measuring. So this is a rate, so it's a 1 over time scale, right? And then what is a microscopic time scale? In a granular system is not easy to define. There is no, again, because of these contact breakings, etc., there is really no microscopic time scale that exists in the absence of an imposed pressure. So now if I give you pressure, let's say a grain diameter and a grain density, can you guys construct something with dimensions of time for me? Okay, you can, I'll write it down because we are running out of time, but you should work it out too. So, that has units of time. So, this is now then a dimensionless number. So, notice that the imposed pressure comes into the definition of this microscopic time and this dimensionless number. Okay. So, in the limit, and again we might mention this, so one thing you should notice is that this dimensionless number, which will enter prominently into defining this rheology that we will talk about for dense flows, has a problem when does this dimensionless number become sort of ill-defined? In what limits? Zero pressure and zero gamma dot. So if I want to take the limit of really, really slow flows, right, and I want to take the limit of P going to zero, I am in trouble, right? So this zero pressure limit is what jamming or unjamming is. So a jammed state unjams at zero pressure. So if I now try to study flows where the pressure is very, very small, then I have to be really careful in how I look at these systems. Right? So it's, so then the order of limits will matter, all kinds of things will happen. It will be a, become a singular limit. So far we are staying away from just low pressure states. Okay, so we have some significant pressure and then we can take the limit of gamma dot going to zero. Okay, so phenomenologically, people find that a very nice description of all kinds of dense flows can be obtained just by saying this mu, which is tau over p, is some function of this I, and the simplest function that you can write down, and that's all I will do, is the same mu s that I put in the critical state. So this is the mu in the limit of I going to zero, so things are not flowing yet, right? So if pressure is finite, gamma dot goes to zero, my I goes to zero, then this tau over p goes to mu s. And then for small i's, it just increases linearly. But phenomenologically, what people find is that mu as a function of I does something like this. So this is mu s, and there is some mu infinity that they reach in the limit of large I. In this regime, I can approximate by a linear behavior. So this rheology, so what do people do with this? This is then telling me this, so I can invert this and write it into, write gamma dot in terms of the imposed shear stress, right? So let's just take this linear relationship and then let's just work it out. So tau over p is mu s plus b times this thing. Right? So invert that p gives me gamma dot is? Divided by a bunch of stuff, right? There's a B D square rho S P. So for tau over P greater than mu S, this is true, gamma dot has to be equal to this. But for tau over P less than mu S, my gamma dot has to be equal to 0. Right? So this is the classic Coulomb yield criterion written in this form. Right? So gamma dot, so the system will flow if tau over P is greater than mu S with some viscosity, if you want to think about it, that depends on pressure. Right? So normal fluids, I would write sigma as a function of gamma dot. Right? So now I'm writing it in terms of pressure. So there's an effective viscosity then that depends on pressure. Okay? So just connecting up to other viscoplastic, so we talked so there is a famous model called Herschel Buckley. So this mu I rheology that actually explains a vast number of dense flows very, very nicely if you just take something like this, is very similar to this Herschel-Buckley law. So the Herschel-Buckley rheology says that the shear stress can be written as some yield stress. So these are yield stress fluids. Yield stress plus some viscosity that depends on gamma dot as some power times gamma dot. That's the way to write it. Right, so remember we talked, so Newtonian solids and Newtonian fluids. So Newtonian fluids, tau just goes as eta times gamma dot, and eta doesn't depend on gamma dot, right? So Newtonian fluid right, this is a fluid. So this is a generalization of that. This is called, these are yield stress fluids, which means it will not flow until my shear stress goes above this yield stress. Once it goes above the yield stress, then it flows, but it can flow with some power law rheologies because the viscosity can depend on gamma dot itself. So I can get shear thinning, I can get shear thickening, I can get things like that. So the viscosity depends on gamma dot. So this mu of I rheology is very much similar to this. The difference is the pressure shows up. So if I think of this as an effective viscosity in these granular Coulomb failure fluids, the viscosity, if I want to think of it as a generalized viscosity, this viscosity depends on pressure, which is not true in other kinds of viscoplastic fluids or Herschel-Buckley fuids. I can have general things, viscosities depend on gamma dot, but viscosities normally don't depend on pressure. So in the granular ones, they do. Okay, I'm quickly running. So this local mu of I rheology, this picture, so what do we do now? So if you give me some kind of granular system confined, let's see, let's say in a couette geometry, all of you know what a couette geometry is? Okay, so couette geometry is the traditional shear cell of, so you have an inner cylinder and an outer cylinder, and you can fill up the middle with anything that you want to, and you rotate the inner cylinder. That's how you shear. And you measure the stress-strain relationships once you do that. So in granular systems, you try to understand what the flow is when you rotate that inner cylinder and ask, what does the velocity profile look like, what do the stresses look like, etc. I'll show you some quet geometry things, I'll bring it tomorrow, I didn't bring any pictures today. So all of those, up to a certain extent, people found that this rheology, this mu of I rheology, works pretty well as long as you take into account the fact that if I have, let's say, a couette cell, this gamma dot will not be constant throughout the couette cell. It will be high near the inner cylinder, it will be low near the outer cylinder. So these things all become fields, they become position dependent. But there is a local relationship. So whatever I is at some point x, my tau over p is related to that. So it's a local relationship, point by point relationship. So this is at some position r, and this is at some position r. But this can be spatially varying. So once I do that, this rheology, you can work out everything, and it works out really well. But then, interestingly, people started probing this a little bit more, and let me just actually go to one experiment. So this is again a quad geometry. So the inner cylinder is being rotated. There are grains between these two cylinders. This, you're controlling this rotation frequency omega. And the first thing you can measure is what's the velocity of the grains as you go away from the center, from this inner cylinder. And what you find is this characteristic that's known in all granular systems of shear localization. So the velocity, the grains near the inner cylinder are flowing, but this profile decays exponentially as I go away from it. So there's this localized region of flow, and further out here, the grains are not flowing at all. Okay. So, but now, what these guys did was something quite interesting. They wanted to see if this local rheology captured all of the physics. Now, the local rheology would say that since this velocity is decaying like this, right, which means gamma dot is decaying like this, so if I'm way out here, I is zero, right? If I'm way out here, I is zero, so my tau over p should also be just mu s, nothing else, right? They wanted to test if that was true, or there were other indications from other experiments saying that that actually doesn't capture all of the physics. So they did a neat experiment. They put a rod out here, far away from this region where the shear zone is. Before they rotate the cylinder, so before I create this shear zone, so the shear zone is created only when I rotate the inner cylinder. So now I have just some stationary grains, I have two cylinders, I have this rod sitting out here. They imposed a force on this rod, so the rod is sitting inside the grains, right? So they put some force on the rod and ask if the rod moves at all. Okay, so if I'm sitting, if I'm putting something, so I have, right, if I have this thing sitting inside my sand, if I want to move it, I'll have to put some critical force on it before it starts moving. So this picture is just saying there is a critical force that I have to exert before the rod starts moving. This is when omega is zero. I'm not rotating this at all. And then what they find is that as soon as I start rotating it, that even for F much, much less than this critical force, the rod starts moving. So even though my grains here are not moving at all, there are some long range fluctuations due to the shear zone that exists near the inner cylinder that's sort of making the rod move. So this is the creep velocity of the rod, right? So the geometry is this. The geometry is this is the distance that the rod is at. I'm imposing some force on it and I'm measuring its velocity. If this thing is not rotating, then the velocity is zero until I reach this critical force. So now they're imposing forces that are less than the critical force. And what they find is this universal relationship between the creep velocity. The force is now less than the critical force, but it's still, there is a non-zero creep velocity. And there is some universal scaling function which depends on how far the rod is from that inner cylinder. So what this is telling us, and what they, forget about this, we don't have time to talk about it, but for someone like Debashish, this is actually Vogel Fulcher. So there is some glassy dynamics going on here. But what it indicates is that there is an activated process that's being initiated by the shear zone near the inner cylinder. So near the inner cylinder, things are flowing, the grains are flowing. I'm looking out here where the grains are not flowing, but there's some noise that's being transmitted that's actually acting like temperature and making the rod move. It's like the rod has to go over a barrier. So this is like a thermally activated barrier hopping thing. But instead of temperature, what's playing the role of temperature is some function that's created by the shear zone at the cylinder. So motivated by these experiments, there has been, okay, I have 5 minutes and I want to get to this Ginzburg-Landau because I want Kabir to talk to you guys about Ginzburg-Landau. So there is a generalization now. So how do we understand these experiments? So there's now a generalization and we can explore this in more detail during the tutorial. There's a generalization which lets you understand these kinds of non-local effects. And what you do is, what we had before was gamma dot was, what was it? Tau over P minus mu S divided by something, right? So I'm going to divide by mu of I and multiply by mu of I. I haven't done anything, right? And then out here I had this B d square rho s over P. So I'm going to call this a quantity called G local. And then to make this, so this is the local rheology that we have talked about so far. So then a group of people came up with the idea that we can actually now understand these fluctuations away from the source by making this a function of position and multiplying it by mu of I. This quantity is called fluidity, and you can see why it's called fluidity, right? So if I just look at the local version of it, this G is 0 when tau over P is less than mu s, and it's not 0 when tau over P is greater than mu s. But this now they make into a field, and the most surprising thing is that the equation that G satisfies, the equation for G that explains all of the phenomenology, it's a completely phenomenological equation, is the following. I have some constant, the grain diameter d square, that's the equation. So if I did not have this term, then what's the solution to my G? If I didn't have this term, right, I just set this to 0, then G would just be mu s minus tau, G would be exactly what I have written down here, okay? But the interesting thing is there's this diffusive term here. Right, so they find that that's what they need to do to explain the experiments. So just thinking about the different terms in here, it tells me that there is a natural length scale appearing in this system. How do I not see that? So these are all G's, but right, so this has a Laplacian in it. Right? So there is a length scale that will, so if I match all of the coefficients, so then there is a length scale that goes as there's a length scale, so the dimension, so am I making sense? So this is, so let's say, how would I solve something like this? Even if I, let's say if I forgot this term, how would I solve something like this? I can do Fourier transform maybe, right? If I just take the linear part of it. If I take just the linear part, then I can do Fourier transform and then I'll get a length scale, right, out of that. So that's, or I can ask, you know, so basically I'm asking, is there a linear instability to a certain wavelength mode, right? And that wavelength, so I see a 1 over length square sitting here in front of the G. So there's certainly a D sitting here. So these are dimensionally making up for the length. So, but this thing has to match up, this mu s minus tau over p, right? So square root of that. So just by matching things here, I'm seeing that there is a length scale, and the, what does this length scale have to do with? This length scale will have to do with diffusion of G, right? So if this was not here, right, if these G terms were not there at all, then this is pure diffusion, there's no length scale associated with it, but this is like doing diffusion but in a potential. So if I do diffusion in a potential, then my diffusion will spread out only up to a certain point, and then it will stop spreading out because I am sitting in a potential, right? And that will give me a length scale which depends on this potential. So as mu s becomes equal to tau, or as tau over p becomes equal to mu s, then I lose that potential, my length scale diverges, right? But as long as I have that potential, then I have some finite length scale. So what these guys do, the continuum theories that have been written down, essentially stop here. They say, okay, there's this length scale. They call this the plasticity length scale. So this is the length scale over which, if I have local failure somewhere, it propagates and tells in up to this length scale and influences the behavior up to that length. Now, for someone like me, this equation is the same as any equation that I would write down for an order parameter like magnetization or something else based on Ginzburg-Landau. And exactly. Right. Right. Exactly. Right. So the first order transition will preempt the divergence of the length scale. But you know, this one I have asked people, do you know that this is the term? They don't. They just put in something. They just put in something. So most of the work that has been done, they have ignored all of this and they have just looked at the linear part of it. So then there is a length scale that shows up. So for those of you who haven't seen something like this, if I think of G as an order parameter that distinguishes, and it is an order parameter, if I think of failure and plasticity as a phase transition, in the sense that this order parameter, if I ignore the Laplacian part of it, is 0 when tau over p is less than mu s, and it's not 0 when tau over p is greater than mu s. So it's two phases, one characterized by g equal to 0, the other characterized by g not equal to 0, but it has this feature that as it approaches the transition, there is a length scale that diverges. Now, in most of the rheology that people have studied, you are looking at confined systems, so the boundaries come in, so no one has ever seen any real diverging length scales, but this is what they seem to need to understand the rheology. Right. So one of the things that we would hope to try and understand is where something like this comes from. So in Kabir's tutorial today, he is going to give you an overview of Ginzburg-Landau theory. So far, this analogy between the equation satisfied by G and what we know and love in Ginzburg-Landau theory in equilibrium stat mag is just an analogy. I have not seen any derivation or you know, is there more fundamental reason that they are similar. But there is this intriguing analogy between these two. And so in Ginzburg-Landau theory, what we have sitting here is T minus Tc, where Tc is the critical temperature. So here what I have is mu s is acting like the critical temperature and tau over p is the distance from the critical temperature. Okay, so it's intriguing that this Coulomb failure plasticity or flow starts looking quite a bit like critical phenomena driven by normal temperature. Okay, let me end there.